longships, battle axes, burning abbeys. These are the defining images etched into our minds from the traumatic period of history known as the Viking Age. When shipborne warriors from Scandinavia unleashed terror across Western Europe and beyond. Taking no prisoners, exacting cruel retribution, priding themselves on their bloodthirsty talents. Who could forget the notorious Vikings?
It was Mark Twain who once said that the very ink with which history is written is merely fluid prejudice. And when it comes to the Vikings, we have tended to see them rather through red-tinted glasses as violent, marauding pagans whose main interests were rape, pillage and, well, more rape and pillage. But a new exhibition here at the British Museum aims to broaden the picture and show that they also had a surprisingly sophisticated taste for art.
Whether the Vikings are interpreted as barbarians or civilizers, the art they created is deeply original and expressive, a bright shaft of light piercing the so-called Dark Ages. Defined by beautiful, intricate styles that are distinctly Scandinavian, yet laced with intrigue and mystery.
So, just for now at least, put aside any preconceptions you may have about bloodthirsty thugs in horned helmets and prepare to be enthralled by the splendours of Viking art.
You can't begin to explore the world of the Vikings or to look at Viking art without first acknowledging some of the bad things they did. In a sense, the Vikings' sins. This is the holy island of Lindisfarne, the site of the first monastery in Britain to be attacked in a Viking raid.
One day in June, 793, a load of Viking longships moored up in that harbour. And they came into this place of monastic retreat and sanctuary, and they desecrated it. They killed the priests, spilled their blood on the altar. The Anglo-Saxon scholar Alcuin wrote that they removed the relics of the saints from their reliquaries, spilled their blood on the stones of the church, and trampled their bones as if it were dung. He finished his lament by asking, where is our God to save us from these pagans?
Early historians came to record the raid on Lindisfarne as marking the beginning of the Viking Age, when the Vikings began an aggressive expansion across Western Europe and beyond. This and the other raids that followed earned the Vikings their reputation for violence.
They knew that the monks would be unarmed. They also knew that they would find some objects here made of silver and gold. I think the Vikings may well have come at night and that they swarmed across the island and simply, as it were, fell on the monastery.
Like stinging hornets, as one of the Anglo-Saxon accounts.
Much worse.
Was there fire involved?
Yes, indeed. The monastery was largely wood, entirely wood at that time, as far as we know, and certainly a good deal of it was burnt down. And then, for some of the people, at least, the whole thing was over very, very quickly. What they saw, I don't think we can imagine.
The raid on Lindisfarne sent shockwaves throughout Anglo-Saxon England. The Vikings had arrived, and they'd made quite an impression.
What's your opinion of the Vikings? What do you think of them as a people? Where do they stand in your estimation?
The Vikings that came here seem to me to be really nothing much more than murderous thugs. I can't think that they came here for any other purpose than to grab, to steal, to raid. And they didn't allow anything whatever to get in their way. And they seem to me to be exactly like a great deal of the extremely horrible things that are happening in the world nowadays. So to me, they're terrorists.
It does seem pretty unlikely that art was on the minds of the Vikings who attacked. But if it had been, ironically, Lindisfarne was the place to come.
When the Vikings raided in 793, Lindisfarne was one of the centres for the production of illuminated manuscripts. And sadly, just one survives, the great Lindisfarne Gospels. Held by the British Library, this is a facsimile, a very good facsimile. And it gives you some idea of the immense skill and sophistication reached by the illuminating artists here on Lindisfarne. Here on the title page of the Gospel of Luke, we see the saint writing away, very much painted in the Greek style, a Byzantine saint. Turn over the page and you enter a completely different world of design and decoration, a combination of Anglo-Saxon pattern making, Roman elements, very much Celtic as well. Now, why is it that the Lindisfarne Gospel managed to survive? Perhaps one of the monks managed to secrete it away just as the Vikings arrived. But we do know that the Vikings were not interested in books. They burned the texts they found in the scriptorium, perhaps as a gesture of contempt for the religion of their enemies. Anything that they didn't consider as booty, they simply destroyed.
Not the behaviour you'd expect, perhaps, from an art-loving people. But over the next 300 years, the Vikings would create their own artistic masterpieces. Viking art, which is to be featured in a new exhibition at the British Museum, the largest exhibition on the Vikings for more than 20 years. The show is being housed in a brand new wing of the museum. And not only will it include some impressive examples of Viking art, but also a gigantic 120-foot long Viking warship.
Wow.
So, this is the new Sainsbury Exhibition Centre.
It's enormous.
It is. It's huge.
Gareth Williams is the exhibition curator, and he's preparing for the delivery of the Viking warship, one of the largest objects the museum has ever put on display.
Tell me about this huge new door that you've had built.
What the door allows us to do, we're on the ground floor, street level of the museum, and for the first time, what this allows us to do is to back a lorry straight into the exhibition space, and we can unload into this space.
And the Viking boat comes out here?
Well, it comes out in sections. It's been basically flat-packed. It's been preserved...
As you do.
It's Scandinavian design. It's been conserved timber by timber. We have round about 20% of the ship itself survives. That's been conserved timber by timber. That comes in one big container, which is carefully conditioned to maintain the right humidity, the right temperature. That can be backed into this space, which will already have been prepared for it, and unloaded directly into this space.
And you reassemble it
and
here?
And we reassemble it here. There's a second container.
Like a very, very complicated piece of IKEA furniture. Does it have a name? Is it called something like Bjorn?
It's called Roskilde 6, simply.
Very perfect.
Well, it's a wonderful story. It was found by chance underneath the Viking Ship Museum in Roskilde. They were building an extension to house all the replicas of the Viking ships they've already got on display there, and they found 9 more ships underneath, including this, including the longest Viking ship ever found.
In a few months' time, the gallery will be crammed full of Viking objects, from the very large to the very small, many of which have never been seen in the UK before. It'll all amount to a multifaceted view of Viking society and Viking culture.
Are you trying to complicate the stereotypical view of the Vikings as a bunch of bloodthirsty raiders, pirates from the north?
What we're showing is there's a breadth to society in the Viking Age. violence and warfare were important parts of this, and it's very much a warrior society, at least at the higher levels of society. But at the same time, trade was one of the driving forces for this huge expansion across the Viking world. And we have craftsmanship, we have poetry. There's a lot going on apart from just hitting people.
I think that should be the strapline to the exhibition. There's a lot going on apart from just hitting people.
Yeah.
It's official.
But the hitting people is important too.
I'll be coming back here a little bit later for a behind-the-scenes look at the preparations for this fascinating exhibition. But to explore the true origins of Viking art, I've got to leave the sanctuary of the British Museum behind and travel to the Viking homeland of Scandinavia.
On my quest, I'll be searching the epic fjords and frozen wilds of the far north for the very stuff of Viking legend. Great beasts, ribbon animals, coiling snakes, the creatures that seem to haunt the Viking mind and live in their art. And it all begins here at the Viking Ship Museum in Oslo, with what's been described as the greatest of all Viking Age discoveries.
This is the Oseberg ship. Absolutely fantastic. We wouldn't have it if it weren't for a farmer called Oscar Rom, who decided in 1903 to dig up an intriguing-looking mound on his farm in Oseberg, about 40 miles away from here. Now, if you think it's impressive from down here, come up to the viewing platform. The ship is 1,200 years old. Astonishing to think that a wooden object could have survived the ravages of being buried underground for that long. But look, isn't that something? How does that survive? How does that survive for so long? And not only is this an extraordinary archaeological find, but it's also a vital relic for our understanding of Viking art, because it's decorated with these ribbons and bands of finely carved animals. In fact, in a sense, the whole thing has been conceived as a piece of seafaring sculpture, because at the far end, you've got a serpent's head, and here you've got a serpent's tail. So the whole thing is designed to resemble a gigantic sea snake riding the waves. What a wonderful object.
It's thought that the Oseberg ship was built around 820 AD, towards the very beginning of the Viking Age. Its discovery caused a sensation in Norway. Nothing quite like it had ever been seen before. The ship had been buried in the ground, in accordance with Viking tradition, following the death of a lady who must have been a very important Viking, perhaps a Viking queen. Her body had been placed together with that of her maid in a specially constructed wooden burial chamber on the top deck of the ship, on board for the great symbolic journey to the afterlife.
I just love this boat. I remember the first time I saw it was 10 years ago, and I walked in and I just felt like a child seeing a dinosaur for the first time. I was just completely overwhelmed.
I mean, if you looked at it, you wouldn't have believed that it was actually made in 820.
So, Sigma, I have to confess, I do sometimes get a little bit confused by the wriggling, tangling nature of Viking illustrations. So how would you advise me to find a beast, well, a particular beast?
Everybody gets confused by these animals. You have to start with head. If you get hold of the head, you're all right. Look for the eye.
If you get hold of the head, you're all right. I like that.
That's
I see the
eye, the round eye.
Yeah.
And you look for the jaws, and their profile in this case. And then you look for the neck, and the neck will take you to the body. So the front portion of the body here, which has been opened up a bit in order to let the animal look through, and then a middle part of the body and the hinder portion of the body, with the legs
and the
here
feet
and there, and feet.
Fantastic. And all this would have been painted?
All of it would have been painted.
And perhaps if it were painted, it might be slightly easier to see.
Yes. And they used reddish, a deep blackish blue.